السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. All praise be to Allah, from whom we seek help and forgiveness. We seek refuge with Allah from the evil of our own souls. Whomsoever Allah guides will never be led astray, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can guide. And I bear witness that there is no God but Allah, the One, having no partner. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Allah's servant and messenger. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد O ye who believe, be mindful of Allah in the way that Allah deserves, and do not die except in a state of full submission to Allah. O humanity, be mindful of your Creator, who created you from a single soul, and from it created its mate, and through both Allah spread countless men and women. And be mindful of Allah, in whose name you appeal to one another, and honor your ties of kinship. Surely Allah is ever watchful over you. O ye who believe, be mindful of Allah and say what is right. Allah will bless your deeds for you and forgive your sins. And whoever obeys Allah and the Messenger of Allah has truly achieved a great triumph. رَبِّ اشْرَحْ لِي صَدْرِي وَيَسِّرْ لِي أَمْرِي وَاحْلُلْ عُقْدَةً مِّن لِّسَانِي يَفْقَهُوا قَوْلِي بِسْمِ اللَّهِ So just as a disclaimer, I am in a room that is very cold, so that I did not anticipate to be this cold. So I might sound like I'm, in and out of it a little bit, but I underestimated the temperature of this room. But bismillah, inshallah, it warms up. So many of us are familiar with the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and if not the whole story of Ibrahim alayhi salam, of many significant portions of the story, or many significant events within the story. We've talked about how Ibrahim alayhi salam and Ismail alayhi salam, had the narrative of sacrifice, how there was story not just of the sacrifice, but then also of the migration to Mecca of Ibrahim, Hajar, and Ismail. We talk about the youth of Ibrahim standing up to his society, standing up to his father, and preaching a message to them and being rejected. So for today's story that I want to lift up for us all is with regards to this story of Ibrahim and the curiosity of faith, but also his younger years. Going off of the statement, the verse in the Quran that says, of this is my Lord, where Ibrahim alayhi salam was kind of, trying to make his stake with regards to the people, trying to state his truth, trying to bring the people to truth, and was kind of left to a point of isolation. And so we will lift that up today, inshallah, but it's very important with regards to our narrative today. This narrative can sometimes feel a little bit hard to follow because there are repetitions of it. I believe Ibrahim alayhi salam is mentioned in the Quran over 73 times. So there's quite a bit of times that Ibrahim alayhi salam is mentioned in the Quran, and this story gets repeated in different iterations, but there's some general continuity. And so Ibrahim alayhi salam, just to open up, we talk about how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Quran tells us, is an uswatun hasan, a best example, a good model for you. But that's not an exclusive use of uswatun hasana, not just for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is also used for Ibrahim alayhi salam in terms of a guidance, a model, a paragon for humanity to have, that Allah addresses humanity that in Surah Mumtahina, in the 60th chapter of the Quran, that you have in Ibrahim an Uswatun Hasana, a good example. So why I chose Ibrahim alayhi salam was that it's an important lesson, not just for us in terms of religiosity and theology, but also with regards to modern ethical dilemmas, maybe standing up for justice, standing up for what is right, or investing so much effort into a cause, but it doesn't maybe come to fruition in our lifetimes. We're going to talk about Ibrahim alayhi salam from his youth up until the point where he departed home, because there's so many lessons that are there. So as I mentioned, Ibrahim, you might not think of Ibrahim as someone who's very relatable, as someone who is, just someone that you can relate to our time, 2021. But Ibrahim in his faith, in his journey, in his interactions is actually going to be seen, inshallah, as someone that you can probably relate not just the circumstances, but the sentiments, the feelings that Ibrahim had towards his family, towards his father, towards all these people that were in his life, and towards God and the interactions that Ibrahim has. And so let's go ahead and let's dive in there. I am just going to step out of this room in just a second here, and we're just going to switch scenes. So I'll be right back. My apologies. Again, I said it was too cold in there and it was getting to me. So inshallah, we'll start here. But Ibrahim alayhi salam, it's very important to see in his example, you have someone that was shown certainty, someone that the Quran mentions that Ibrahim was shown to be among the certain, among al-muqinun. That in Surah Anbiya, the Quran says that we had granted Ibrahim sound judgment earlier on. We saw from his early life, and we knew him to be worthy of it. So Ibrahim is also told to have come to his Lord with a sound heart, a qalbun salimun, and a heart that has purity, but also a heart that's just genuine. And in the example of Ibrahim, especially in the earlier years and in the adulthood, we have someone who is very relevant for us, regardless of our age, for a time in which we might be seen as the outcast, when we might be seen as a lone voice, regardless of cause. Ibrahim's story can be given many parallels and analogies in our time, as we're going to talk about, simply by substituting his father and his people's idols for things that are essentially objects of worship in our time. So we're going to take a look at a simple example for our case. We're going to talk about maybe money. Let's put money in our time as we navigate this story of Ibrahim's youth, of Ibrahim's upcoming, of Ibrahim's kind of definiteness and defining himself, both in context as well as the significance and relevance to us today. So childhood of Ibrahim. Let's just start from there. There's no mention of Ibrahim's mother in the Quran. So for our purposes, let's just assume that from the information that we have, that he has a single dad, Azar. So Azar is named in the Quran as his father, or Ibrahim addresses him as, Ya Abati, my father, and his mom is not in the picture. There's no mother in the picture. So let's keep that in mind, because for our society, it's a really relevant in the country that we live in, if we're in America here, that according to a Pew Research poll, the US has the world's highest rate of children living in single parent households. So almost a quarter of US children under the age of 18 live with one parent and no other adults. That's almost 23%. So it's a really staggering number, but it also gives us some relevant that Ibrahim would kind of fit in to the society we have today, because that is something that circumstantially, it looks like that is the case with him and his upbringing. But he grew, let's talk about also maybe, or just think about how this might affect a child's development if they're not properly cared for, or provided for, yet seeing how Ibrahim, especially in that society, was able to grow, not just grow into a strong person, but someone with a strong ethical component, a strong moral lens, despite the fact that he was of a single parent household. So this shows that there's that potential for it, and not to disregard children, not to disregard persons that are from these households, and instead see the gifts that they have. And Ibrahim, as we'll see, things didn't really get much better for him, for having just a single father. We see that Ibrahim
grew up to an idol maker. His father Azar was involved in, you know, making idols and selling idols. And, you know, this in and of itself speaks so many volumes, because of the fact that one, it tells us that you know, we're not going to be judged by our parents' sins and our actions. When we talk about Ibrahim, and we talk about other people in our society, especially if you're Desi, if you're, you know, South Asian, you oftentimes, and if you're Arab as well, you oftentimes link back to, well, who is your father? Who was your father? And if your parents or your father did something bad, we have this tendency to move towards this original sin kind of model and say, well, you know, you're from that family, or you're from that father, or you're from that parent, and they didn't do good, or they did something, so we automatically associate you with that. But in this narrative, in this figure, Ibrahim, who's not just a uswatun hasana, a good model, a perfect example, but someone who would become known as the father of the prophets, we have someone who comes from a parent who is almost the antithesis of what the Quran is trying to preach. And so let's now take that into our narrative. Let's take that into our society that we're living in today. So Azar is an idol maker. Azar is an idol maker, and he is raising his son Ibrahim. And let's think that when we're talking about this comparison of our society to that time in a linear fashion, let's say that Azar wouldn't exactly be somebody working a job that would be totally halal by our standards. Again, we're taking money as our example. So not to jump to any conclusion about certain professions that deal with money or anything like that, but let's just say Azar in our time could be a loan shark, could be someone that loans money at an extremely high interest rate and uses, you know, threats of violence to collect debts. So loan sharks are notorious for charging high interest rate loans that are above a legal rate. And then they're maybe always, not always, but oftentimes involved in organized crime. So there's a lot of messy business that's there. There's a lot of dark money that's there. But basically using this concept of money to a degree that debilitates, but also becomes so crippling and so toxic in a way. And so Ibrahim's dad in that then as now would be involved in some kind of a business, some kind of a trade of loan lending, or something that we would see as that the society would probably see as commonplace. Oh, it's common to, you know, trade in high interest. It's common to, you know, lend people loans like this. So it's seen as normative, yet it still doesn't make it appropriate, nor does it make it compatible with God's plan. In any case, in both settings, both in Ibrahim alayhi salam's history and in our own parallel with the world today, Ibrahim was growing up in a home where money wasn't clean. The money coming in was not clean, but he was still imbued with strong ethical values. We see how in the Quran it says that we gave Ibrahim the kind of guidance. We gave Ibrahim sound judgment earlier on. This was one of his gifts. Being raised in this home, he was naturally going to develop into somebody that was going to run into a conflict or ask some of the questions that dug at this unethical practice. So Ibrahim was a naturally inquisitive and curious child and a young man who was no stranger to confrontation. We see how Ibrahim started by questioning his father numerous times in the Quran. We see this this narrative play out, but in Surah Maryam, in the 19th chapter, we see Ibrahim approach his father and say, "Oh, my father, why do you worship that which does not hear and does not see and will not benefit you? Oh, my father, indeed, there has come to me of knowledge that which has not come to you. So follow me. I will guide you to a straight and even better path." And it sounds like Ibrahim took a college course or some seminar on ethical financing or Islamic finance or lending. And now he has this knowledge. He is now working to give his father nasiha, correct him. You can guess how his father takes it. Just imagine, like I said, when we're thinking about this story, think about the parallel to our world today. If we educate ourselves about something, especially in ethical terms, and we try to educate someone who might be in the wrong on it, especially if it's our family member, oftentimes that might not go over as well. And you can probably guess how Ibrahim's father took it. He said that, "Have you no desire for my gods, O son?" Like, have no desire for my gods or my idols, Ibrahim? "If you do not desist, I will surely stone you. So get away from me for a long time. You know, go away from me. And Ibrahim said in response, peace be upon you. I will ask forgiveness for you from my Lord, and he is ever gracious to me, and I will leave you and those you invoke other than Allah, and I will invoke my Lord. I expect that I will not be in invocation to my Lord unhappy. And so we see Ibrahim kind of already having a very highly attuned sense of dealing with not just conflict, but being able to address his father in a way that was not, you know, we sometimes get latched on to our parents or people are around us, our friends are doing something so unethical. And we get to that point that we don't see it clearly in terms of how do we address them properly? How do we respond when they tell us no? We see Ibrahim said, you know, peace be upon you. I will, if I can't, you know, desist from this way, I will do something else in a more spiritual way. And so Ibrahim at this time then gets kicked out of the house as a young man. So for our comparison to our society, we often hear this narrative of when someone turns 18, their parents sometimes kick them out or they get the boot out of the house. So Ibrahim, being this young man, gets, says a few things, and his father finally says, like, you know what, you know, if you're not going to like the family business, if you're not going to honor the trade that we're in, if you're not going to honor this stuff, we're going to go ahead and have you leave. And so he kicks him out of the house. And his father is no longer responsible for him. But now we see how Ibrahim is following this maxim of justice that the Prophet ﷺ had taught us, that standing up for justice, not just if it's against yourself, but also if it is against your own parents and your neighbors and your relatives, as the Quran so eloquently iterates. But we see that that Ibrahim alayhi salam did not stop by questioning his father. He went to the society in general. He goes to, if it doesn't work for, he obviously has gotten his own ducks in a row, so he's not worried about maybe himself in terms of going in one way or another. But he then goes to his society, to the people around him. So now just envision that your parent, your immediate family member is involved in this illegal activity or involved in this activity that's not beneficial spiritually or just in any sense morally or ethically. And so he now goes to the wider society of the society of merchants, the society where this money is abound, where people are all trading and everybody is abound. And so he goes now, with his father being a loan shark, the money launderer, the subprime lender, whatever you want to call him, who's working in a society of people who are also engaged in loan sharking, dark money, high interest lending, all that stuff, exploitation. Ibrahim now confronts the society. So now he goes there. And in Surah Anbiya, says that, remember when Ibrahim questioned his father and his people that, what are these idols to which you are so devoted? And they responded that, you know, we found our forefathers worshiping them, that there are gods because we found our forefathers worshiping them. And Ibrahim responds very, very strongly that indeed you and your forefathers have clearly been astray. He immediately refutes their forefathers, but he also makes it a point to not just kind of get at their logic in terms of logically tell them why what they're doing is wrong. You know, that he preaches a similar message of they can't hear, they can't speak, they can't do. Like, what are you going to do? Like, you know, how are you worshiping these things which have no agency of their own? And so we see then that Ibrahim goes and he then kind of attacks the idol. So he attacks whatever their idols are, whatever is kind of making these folks deviant, deviating them from Allah. We reflect back onto our time and we think about who or what are our idols. For our example here, we have money, but money is a huge idol for so many of us in this society. And so how do we confront that? But we see that Ibrahim also in his story, we're talking about Ibrahim 2021, as well as from the Quranic narrative, that Ibrahim 2021 does the same as Ibrahim in history. And now he has to find a means to get his message across. He has to find a means to put some certainty, not just to his faith, but also to the people around him, to see that, hey, there is a, this is a flawed system. This is something that is not beneficial. And so we call that civil disobedience. This is famous in the civil rights movement, that you're doing something in which you are demonstrating, you're causing a bit of a protest or whatever it might be for the purpose of raising a flag that shows that this is indeed an issue. And so Ibrahim ends up taking an axe. He takes an axe, or, you know, in some narrations it has his hand, and he just breaks some of the idols. But he goes and he takes out the idols that are there, with except to the largest one that's there. And he puts the axe at the feet of this idol. And we see the parallel to various forms of civil disobedience and protests that we have here. So he's done this. And now, as we'll see in a bit, you know, people are come back, they're like, what happened to our idols? Like, somebody must have done this. And Ibrahim uses this as a ploy to say, like, well, you know, why don't you ask them? Why don't you ask the idols, like, who did it, if they are your gods? And so it shows us a parallel of various forms of civil disobedience and protests, which are done in our times, to illustrate the harms of a system or of an issue that sometimes we can't see the full picture of. It might be a stretch, but just think about Ibrahim, you know, in the context of this money that we're talking about, making a gesture. Maybe he takes a dollar, maybe he takes some currency and he burns it, or he tears it apart, or he does something to this money to get it away. This is money that's been taken in through very toxic means. This is money that's used to exploit people and has been taken from exploitative means. Or maybe he just goes and he just toilet papers the stock exchange. Maybe he just goes and, like, you know, spray paints something. He does something else. But basically, he carries out a form of civil disobedience in order to make a point. And he replied in the Quran sarcastically that when he was asked, that you're the one who did it. Like, you know, did you do this? Like, we heard you talking some rumblings about taking down our idols. Is this you? And he replied sarcastically that no, this one, the biggest of them, did it. Like, look, he's got the axe at his feet. You should go ask him. And so ask them if they can talk. Oftentimes we see this narrative being played, but it's just important to see that Ibrahim was not just someone working out of a place of anger. He didn't just see, like, I don't like your idols, I'm going to smash them, and that's the end of that. I'm just going to cause property damage. No, Ibrahim alayhi salam was very wise, was very calculated, and as the Quran shows, had sound judgment. So knew that what he would do, it's not just a form of just riling up the masses. He's not just going to go desecrate something just because it's his right to do that, or he's just going to make people inflamed. He is going to do something in a sense that makes people understand why he did it. So after he did that, and people, you know, go back and they're a little bit confused, as people are like, you know, well, what do we do? Like, you know, that they don't talk, like, they're idols, they're stone, they're wood, they can't respond. And so they're in a bit of a confusion, but finally their confusion overcomes them as well. And they're like, you know what, we're going to toss him in the fire. Let's burn him at the stake. Let's do this. Let's just get him out. He's too much of a rebel. So then we see Ibrahim gets essentially a life or death sentence, whatever you want to call it, for his action. And in our society, you can probably say that he was incarcerated. He was put in prison. That, you know, his he was sentenced to a place that was away from the society, but where society thought that he would be punished for his crime or punished for what he did. Instead, that fire became a means of peace. The Quran talks about how we said to the fire, "Be cool and be peaceful," to Ibrahim. And so the mob, the group of people, the society had said, you know, burn him up to avenge our gods if we must act. And society sought to rid themselves of Ibrahim by putting him in a place, like I said, where he was to made to be feeling the heat. Whenever we see someone commit a crime, we're like, yeah, that person should go to jail, that person should go to prison, or that person should do this. Like, if they earned it, if they did something really bad, we will say that because we think of prison not as a place where they're just going to go and jump on trampolines all day and have a great time and, you know, not worry about anything. They will go and be corrected in some way, shape, or form. It's not a pleasant place to be. And so we see that, you know, society wants him just rid of, you know, to get rid of him, and that experience is going to burn him. but the fire was made cool and peaceful. Paralleling this to our time today, I've shared this in previous iterations, but I've worked with different inmates, Muslim inmates, throughout the week and throughout the month. And I can't tell you how many brothers who've been incarcerated or who are behind bars have mentioned finding peace and respite in a place of punishment. Jail, or in the prison system. They find Islam in the prison system. They finally get a gap in their space from this. And so they are able to finally have some time away, and they get that peace. And so Ibrahim got that peace. Ibrahim was incarcerated by the system. He was locked in a high security prison, which we'll call this fire, but he was given solitary for this crime. But his incarceration was a means of actualization and growing into his true self. Ibrahim had an idea. He knew that something wasn't right. He acted on it, and the society punished him according to their punishment. But Allah made that punishment, that worldly punishment, that clouded societal punishment, a way for him to grow. So let's say then that Ibrahim caught parole, or he was able to get outside, get some outside time during this exilic experience. Alone he was one night then, where we come to the crux of our topic here, inshallah, that and as the Quran relates, that he was either taken there by some people, or in some other stances, he was there just by himself. That Surah An'am describes a scene that, lo, Abraham said to his father Azar, you take idols for gods, for I see you and the people in clear error. And it sounds like his father, in our parallel, might have paid him a visit while he's in prison, or he's giving him a visit, and he sees that Ibrahim's resolve is not broken. So also, did we show Ibrahim the power and the laws of heaven and earth that he might understand and have certitude? When the night covered Ibrahim, he saw a star. He said, "This is my Lord." But when the star set, he said, "I love not those that set." When he saw the moon rising in splendor, he said, "This is my Lord." But when the moon set, he said, "Unless my Lord guides me, I surely shall be among those who go astray." And when he saw the sun rising in splendor, he said, "This is my Lord, the greatest of all." But when the sun set, he turned and said to his people, "Oh, my people, I am indeed free from your guilt of associating partners with Allah. For me, I have set my face firmly and truly towards Allah, who has created the heavens and the earth, and never shall I give partners to Allah." So in these powerful verses, you know, some light is thrown on the mental experience in which Ibrahim passed in the beginning, and that leads him to an understanding of truth before prophethood. So this is before prophethood was bestowed upon him. This experience shows how a right-thinking and sound-hearted person had opened their eyes in a very hostile environment, had not received kind of any instruction in terms of teaching of the deen, was ultimately led to discover the truth of the deen by careful observation, by serious reflection, as well as by grounded action, by rooting himself in what was ethically right. And so we see that the conditions that were prevailing, the people, it was dominated by a worship, not just of idols, but also of the heavenly bodies. And so you have the moon, the stars, the sun. And it was natural that Ibrahim began his quest for truth. Like, you know, he went and asks, like, you know, are any of these celestial bodies, are these God? Like, you know, that's not what he was asking. He was kind of wanting to address the question again, thinking logically, could this be God? So oftentimes when we see these verses played out, we sometimes slip into thinking that, oh, Ibrahim was like thinking like, "This is my God, this is my God, this is my God." And kind of, you know, having this moment of associating different partners with Allah. But in fact, it's actually maybe closer to something that, could it be that, you know, is it really so that this is God? Is it really so that that's God? Is it really so that that's God? Because it's not like Ibrahim hadn't seen the stars before. It's not like Ibrahim hadn't seen the sunrise and sunset, or the moon rise and the moon set. Ibrahim was asking these questions and making these statements as a way for reflection. And so a reflecting mind doesn't react uniformly to similar observations. We lift up the example that when Isaac Newton discovered gravity and the apple falls on him, it wasn't the first time he probably saw something fall. He's probably, you know, lived through life, see people drop things and see things fall all over the place. But it was in that moment where he's sitting underneath that tree that something falls, and he's in that state of reflection, in that state of thinking, that it finally hits him. It's like, this is something here. And so the reflecting mind doesn't react uniformly to similar observations, to just being about that someone might be observing something over and over and over again. And this observation might not stir anything in their mind, but then there comes a moment when suddenly the same observation gets to their mind and gets their faculty in a way that they had not thought of before. And it might be that they're wrestling with that problem, but it comes about when we're in deep contemplation. For the sake of time, I want to just kind of get to towards the end here, inshallah. But as we see, you know, Ibrahim was someone who was a seeker after truth. So he had to pass through these deliberations, these little stages in terms of like, I've talked to my people, I've talked to them, yet I get to this point where I'm asking questions. Is this God? Is that God? Could that even be God? He doesn't come to a direct conclusion. He's not saying that this is God, this is God, this is God, this is, you know, like definitely like this is God. It's more in the sense of seeing that, could this be God? And so we see that Ibrahim was not someone that kind of delineated into shirk, but was someone who was very much a curious seeker of truth, was someone that was trying to connect the dots that could this be God? Because just before this experience, he makes it very clear that you people, my father included, you all are associating partners with God, that something is wrong, that you all are doing something here and that's wrong. So it doesn't make sense that he would go out and say, okay, so now I know who God is, but you know, these three are also maybe God. He's trying to connect the dots in terms of like, could this even be God? Because this comes and goes, comes and goes, comes and goes. And so it's just important to recognize that, but also that Ibrahim was seeking. He was seeking. He had an idea. He had a conception of what this might be, but he didn't know, like he didn't have a groundedness until it was revealed, until the truth came revealed to him. After this night, after this time, it's more so that he had become a prophet. This was his liberation in our world. And so he then goes back to his people. He goes and invites them and goes to not just challenge his people, but challenges the leaders of that time. We have the famous interaction that he has with Nimrod, the King Nimrod, and who says that, you know, I'm basically God. I give life, I give death. And the Quran talks about this in Surah Baqarah, where Ibrahim says that Allah brings up the sun from the east. So why don't you bring it up from the west if you're God? And he was just like, well, you got me there. Like, I can't do it. Again, thinking that Ibrahim is a very logical person. He's not just someone coming in with an axe, smashing idols, saying, I don't like this. And I hate that this is idolatry. I hate all this. He's logically trying to play onto his people. Why doesn't this work? Why does this not make sense? Do you people not reflect on why this could not make sense? And so we see Ibrahim eventually had to leave his home. And I will conclude on this point here, inshallah, just for the sake of time, that Ibrahim had to leave his home. Ibrahim eventually was driven out. And he says in Surah Ankabut that I will leave my home for the sake of Allah, for he is exalted in might and wise. Inni muhajirun, that I'm a muhajir. We're very familiar with that term of muhajir, someone who migrates for the sake of Allah. And Ibrahim had to leave his place, leave his father, leave his people. After that, he had all these revelatory experiences. He had all this stuff, yet Ibrahim could not convince his people. He couldn't even convince his own father that to change, to make that change. And so he did what most of us feel unable to do. He eventually left. He said, you know what? I'm giving up. Not giving up. I'm moving. I'm leaving. That I have to leave. I have to go to another place. And he was urged to move. He left. But Ibrahim's story didn't end in the typical triumph that we think of, or at least that he might have hoped for. He might have wanted that all his society converts, all his father converts. We might have had more of a Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam type of story in which the society converts after a while, but that's not something that had happened with him after this juncture. Ibrahim alayhi salam left probably feeling defeated, you know, leaving your father's home, leaving the home city that you were in for so long, that nobody had at least recognize here in mass converted to your message. So what does it say for us that when we invest something so much into our lives, we invest in something that like our time, blood, sweat, tears into something, into somebody to change them, to see that this is the right way and they don't respond as we want. How often do we get feeling left as if we're failures? I imagine Ibrahim alayhi salam maybe had a feeling that I feel like a failure. Like, you know, I didn't get anything. Like, you know, my father wouldn't even join. But we see that what Ibrahim came to God with was a qalbun salimun, a very sound heart, was something with sound judgment. And he knew in his heart that regardless of what would happen, he still was with Allah. And Allah blesses Ibrahim with the title of Khalilullah, the friend of Allah. But we see that this curiosity isn't just something, and this love for Allah is not just something that gets Ibrahim out there and now he's like, I'm a definitive person for Allah, and I will not ask any more questions. I'm just going to preach and do what I can. Ibrahim ends up asking more questions of Allah. And the last thing we'll close out with here is in Surah Baqarah in verse 260, there's a famous narration of the birds that Ibrahim says, "My Lord, show me how you give life to the dead." And Allah responds and says, "Do you still not believe? Like, what's up with you?" Ibrahim says, "Bala, yes, but I, you know, walakin liyatma'inna qalbi, that yes, but just to put my heart at rest. You know, I just want to know. So just give, let me satisfy my heart. Let me know." And we see that this is a part and parcel of our faith, is not just a curiosity, but a sincere curiosity and certainty attached to our faith, that we might not always resonate with it. We might not always connect with it in certain ways, but we might not understand everything all the time. But there's a deeper meaning that can connect us. There's a deeper thing that can allow us to connect with it. And so it's not wrong to ask those questions. It's not wrong to try and be curious and think about these things. The Quran says numerous times that will you not reflect, that these signs have been made for you to reflect, to ponder on. And in Ibrahim's story, we see this curiosity, but we also see this reflection and just the logical aspect of sitting with a certain situation and thinking about, could this be? So the takeaway here for us, brothers and sisters, inshallah, is to ask those questions and sit with those questions, sit with those moments, but also don't get discouraged if something that you put so much time into does not come to play as you see it. Inshallah, there's different ways of deriving the benefit. For Ibrahim, he took this long arc of going through a fire, going through his dad's yelling, going through exile, going through his people, going through a king, you know, yelling at him and all this different stuff, only to come to the same point that he was at the beginning. But so much had happened, and now look at us in our society now. Ibrahim may not have been able to convert or save his people, change them or the father, but he became the father of the prophets. He became someone very beloved who put together something that outlived him and continues up until this day, in which we always close with a dua that invokes Ibrahim alongside the Prophet ﷺ in continuing to bless Ibrahim, his progeny, and the mission that Ibrahim had continued here. So inshallah, we'll conclude with this. وَآخِرُ وَدَعْوَانَا أَنِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ عِبَادَ اللَّهِ رَحِمُكُمُ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنكَرِ وَالْبَغْيِ يَعِظُكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ اذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ يَذْكُرْكُمْ وَادْعُوهُ يَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ وَلَذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ O servants of Allah, may Allah be merciful to you. Verily, Allah commands you to act with justice, to confer benefits upon each other, and to do good to others as one does to one's kindred, and forbids evil from which you pertain to yourselves, and evil which affects others, and prohibits unlawful rebellion against lawful authority. He warns you against being unmindful. You remember Allah, Allah too will remember you. Call upon Allah, and Allah will make a response to your call. And verily, divine remembrance is the highest virtue. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidum majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidum majid. Jazakallah khair for coming to our khutbah space today, brothers and sisters. And again, my apologies for the transition in the space as well as for time. But inshallah, just to wrap up with quick announcements here. Please note we have a new Facebook group that is up. We are trying to engage the community in different ways and engage, keep you all connected. So if you're on Facebook, we have a Facebook group. Just check out our Facebook page. It's linked in there. Please note we have a upcoming event this Sunday on the Prophet's love for diversity, equity, and inclusion. This is a workshop that is intentionally focused on showing how the prophetic example and the companions modeled racial inclusion as part of the ministry of Islam, as part of the message of Islam. This is happening on Sunday at 6 p.m. So please do register. Yeah, we emailed this out, but we'll also post it onto our social media. So you can find it on our website. You can find it anywhere there, but be sure to register this. It'll be a really great event done in conjunction with the Association of Muslim Chaplains. We're going to continue our Upholders of Justice Halaqa series with social justice and activism in Islam, featuring Sister Alia Salim, who is a founder of FACE, Facing Abuse in Community Environments. And so we'll continue the conversation. That's happening on Thursday, October 21st. So we still got a little bit of time, but every third Thursday of the month, we're going to have this halakha. So last time we had Omid Safi, this next time we have Alia Salim. And then we have our book club, which is going to be meeting tonight, actually, at 7 p.m. So the book that we'll be discussing is The Forgotten Queens of Islam by Fatima Mernissi. So even if you haven't read the book, you are welcome to just join for the discussion. But you can see our website to get a PDF of the book, or you can buy it from Amazon or any other place there. But we're going to be talking about that. Lastly, you're always welcome to come to the chaplain's office hours, which are by appointment, 7 days a week. If you'd ever like to talk to me or just have kind of an exchange and conversation, just check in with me. You're welcome to just send me an email, go to the website. We have a chaplain's page that's there and reach out. I'd be happy to talk to you. But jazakallah khair for coming out to our khutbah today. And I hope you have a blessed Friday, inshallah.